Supervisors of the County of Del Norte and the governing body of all special assessment and taxing districts for which the board so acts is now meeting in regular session. Only those items that indicate a specific time will be heard at the assigned time. All other items may be taken out of sequence to accommodate the public and staff availability. It is Valentine's Day. Happy Valentine's Day, everyone. A little love in your heart. And it's red. I remind myself to get some flowers today. So at this time, we will have a short moment of reflection. Okay, and our flag salute will be conducted today by Supervisor Callan.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do we have introduction of any new employees to the Board of Supervisors today, Jay? No. Okay. At this time, are there any actions out of closed session to report it by County Council?
Yes. In the matter of Alice Brown, the Board of Supervisors voted 4-0 with a motion by Supervisor Berkowitz and seconded by Supervisor Cowan to defend that lawsuit. And the Board of Supervisors voted with a motion with a vote of 4-0 to initiate litigation with a motion by Supervisor Hemmingson and a second by Supervisor Cowan.
Now, at this time, the chair requests any deletions, corrections, or additions from board members to the agenda at this time. In order to add an agenda item, the matter must have come to the attention of the county subsequent to the posting of the agenda, and the matter requires action before the next regular meeting at the Board of Supervisors, which will be February 28th. Are there any such requests at this time?
Mr. Chairman, I request that
Supervisor Berkowitz add the
Great American Renewal Plan to the agenda, which was asked for by board members at the last meeting. And also, I would like to ask that a resolution regarding Senate Bill 54 be added to the agenda.
Okay, on the first issue, is that in the form of a motion? That you're making a motion at this time?
That's in the form of a motion.
Okay, I'll ask for a second. I'll second that.
Okay.
So at that time, let's deal with that one right now first before we move to the second one. So I'll ask for any public comment, or would you rather at this time explain what this particular Great American Plan is all about, Supervisor?
Well, Mr. Chairman, on January 20th, the President shocked many of us when he wanted to invest $1 trillion in infrastructure improvements into counties. He said that his intention was to transform America's crumbling infrastructure and make investments in transportation, clean water, a modern, reliable electricity grid, among other projects. Since that time, many states and municipalities have introduced ideas to include their own priority projects into this mix. In fact, Governor Brown has already identified $59 billion in needed improvements in maintenance for the state's roads, highways, and bridges. And among the other hundreds of projects, one project, of course, is missing. And that one is, as you can guess, the funding for a bypass at Last Chance Grade. At the last meeting, I said that if we wanted last chance grade to be built, we needed to have a plan in the mix. As a result, supervisors wanted to have that plan presented. In fact, Supervisor Hemmingson said, "I want to see the plan." Supervisor Cowan said, "This board needs a plan." Supervisor Gitlin said, "This plan is necessary." And while all of us wanted to have a plan, we won't get that chance at this meeting. And why is that? It's because the chairman, who's not here today, refused to include it in the agenda. He let me know in a conversation that he wanted to be here when it's presented. And as you know, he's in Japan this week. So unfortunately, events just don't wait for the chairman to return. In world events as your own household, you know that proper timing is everything. A case in point, if the State of Jefferson resolution had been voted on 1 week earlier in 1941, instead of a week later in 1941, we would probably all be saluting the State of Jefferson flag today. Timing is everything. If President Lincoln had attended Ford's Theater performance of Our American Cousin on Saturday instead of Friday, we might all be living in a much different world today. Timing is everything. 2 weeks from now, many of the infrastructure plans could well be finalized. 2 weeks from now, it just may be too difficult to get any plan that we might have in the mix. And who's to say that all five of us will be here at the next meeting? If it only can be brought up when five of us are here, that could be a long wait. So we have a decision to make. We will hear a plan, hopefully, that everyone else at this dais has asked for. Or we can wait and hope someone else includes last chance grade in their plans. And that's the reason for this motion today, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Supervisor Berkowitz. I'm going to open it up now to the public. Those of you who wish to approach the dais, please come up, identify yourself, whether you are a county resident or a city resident. Come right up, sir.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I've yet to hear a plan.
Well, I think we're...
So what are we commenting on?
I think we're...
What are we introducing?
Okay.
What are
hold, we... Hold on. May I have order, please. May I have order, please. I think we're deciding on whether we want to put it on the agenda to discuss the plan today rather than 2 weeks since. Now, Supervisor Berkowitz, well, am I hearing you correctly?
That's correct.
Okay.
Well, there's a process that it needs to meet certain criteria to be able to be put on the agenda as an urgency item. And without looking at this, how do I know if this meets the urgency criteria?
Council, would you please opine on this?
So in order to meet the urgency item, two-thirds of the members present must, which is a 3-4 vote in this case, decide that there's a need to take emergency action, and the need came to the attention subsequent to the agenda being posted. I have some real concerns about this in terms of the Brown Act, which I know that some of you know already. In the publication for cities regarding the Brown Act, it states that it gives some examples that a new need does not arise because staff forgot to put the item on the agenda or because an applicant missed a deadline, and that too casual of an action could invite a court challenge. It gives those examples, and I think in this case it's an issue of the chair not putting the item on and having known about that item, and so I would be concerned about it meeting that urgency definition. It's not my decision, it's you all decision as a vote two-thirds, but that would be the concern.
Okay, I appreciate that. I do want to remind our audience here that in our Del Norte County manual, It says 1.10.010, paragraph B, any member of the board may place an item on the agenda after for action after first consulting with the chairperson of the board, which was done in a timely manner. Now, my understanding, the exigency of this matter came after the agenda was established and before the actual posting. Is that correct, Council?
My understanding, and
before
this
it was
is
actually
what I,
posted.
This is what I got from Supervisor Berkowitz, is that that he did submit the item prior to the agenda being posted, and that it was a decision by the chair not to place it on this month's agenda. And I can't opine on the admin manual, as it's a procedural manual, but I can just tell you about the Brown Act and the concerns on that.
Point well taken. I think at this time, since we're discussing it, we're not at that point where we even have information. The exigency of the matter is things are moving quite quickly in Sacramento on a number of issues, and money is going to be allocated and spent. So I'm going to, at this point, allow the public to opine in on this. Supervisor Cowan, yes?
This was brought to my attention, the urgency. It's not, I don't think there's anyone in this room who doesn't agree that we need to go forward, me included. I think it's very, very urgent. But this is being brought by Supervisor Berkowitz that it's an emergency to do now, instead of waiting for a full board. So in my due diligence, I completely checked the governor's website. I did a lot of research this weekend. He has put out ideas of what he wants done. They're only in newspapers. There's nothing in writing. I then took a step further and contacted somebody directly in DC, our representative, our lobbyist, and talked to him about this 100A that Trump has. And I was very much told that it is just talk, that there is no urgency. What's going to be in the 100A is talk of how to get funding for our infrastructure, but not a program plan. I personally just feel that we need a full board. This is a huge decision. But 2 weeks is not urgent. It's not going to make a difference, as they're saying it is. There's nothing in place right now. Nothing has been submitted by our governor. There is no program from Trump administration at this time.
Point taken. I'm going to respectfully disagree with your comment, and I see we have a divided board on this. That's why I do want to hear from the public on this. That there are things that are happening, and whether we think they're moving at a fast pace or not is not really the issue. The issue is, does this board have a right to introduce something on what may be arguably considered an exigent matter? As is perceived, the things are moving quickly. So on that basis, with all due respect, Supervisors Hemmingson and Cowan, I'm going to allow the public to opine on this. So if you wish to make a statement with regard to the Great American Plan as introduced by, yet for discussion, by Supervisor Berkowitz, please do. And identify yourself and your city, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm Chuck Blackburn, a private citizen, but also a former Board of Supervisors member and a member of a committee, sir, that you put together with Kirk Schremberg and I on Last Chance Grade. We've worked together, I believe it's 3.5 years as a group. And I must say, our little group has accomplished a tremendous amount behind the scenes, mostly all the way from Curry County all the way through Sonoma County, with travel, communications, and getting, including this county, preliminary support for the philosophy of the Last Chance Grade bypass. And that became an urgency with a lot of people, not only in this county but other counties, particularly Humboldt County. And I know that you personally, in a previous board, tried to bring this on the agenda to declare an emergency with Caltrans and this county take a lead, which it should, because Last Chance is in this county. To me, the rationale was we take the lead, we reach out to those other four counties and get their emergency type proclamations as well. It's never happened. You could never get it on the board agenda with a previous board, and it disturbed a lot of us greatly, and there are a lot of people out there disturbed by it. and it's time that we do get urgent. I don't want to interfere in the inner workings of this board today. That's not my purpose. My purpose is the urgency of last chance grade. We need an emergency proclamation soon from this board to take the lead so we can get other support. There have been private contacts made with folks in the head office of Federal High Administration in Denver. I personally know a gentleman, and put them in touch with Caltrans in Region 1. This person didn't even know about last chance grade in Denver, Colorado, and it surprised me greatly. And those folks are working behind the scenes right now to find out more about last chance grade. That's my concern, and I hope that this board, not that you're all is going to be 5-0 and everything, but my hope that this board will be open and search yourselves for the real drive by this community. And there are so many people in this community that want to see a quick solution to last chance grade, and we have the quick solution. But politically, it's a nightmare. So I think you all know the urgency. With that, I'll leave it at that. And I just hope that we can get this moving forward big time. And I hope it's sometime soon that we can get a proclamation of emergency with Caltrans, and which will help them. And when a leading official Caltrans told me that at this very boardroom last January 29th, you know, Chuck, you need to get political pressure on Caltrans. So with that, thank you for the opportunity. Bob, thank you for your effort to do what you're trying to do on this. And good luck to all of you. I respect you greatly.
Thank you, Supervisor Chuck Blackburn. Are there any other comments from the audience on asking to discuss today this Great American Plan? Please come up. Identify yourself, Kurt Stremberg, and you're worthy city.
I'm Kurt Stremberg, and part of the committee that was formed for a bypass around last chance grade. And I think the biggest concern that I have here is that we've heard time and time again from different individuals that it needs to take its course. And a course of 29 years to wait for construction doesn't sound very reasonable at this point. I think we need to move proactively, and that's why we're asking you to go ahead and take a position that will move this thing to its next level, and it needs to move forward. We can't sit here and just wait for something to happen. Or as Steve Prokoff told me at Redwood National Park, he says, we just need an earthquake, just a small one, not a big one. Now, if we're going to wait for that, and we wait for 3 or 4 years or 5 years of construction, we'll be in the same boat we were in 1964 after the flood. And how many generations will we have to wait to recover from that as we would from this? And so that's why we need your aggressive movement in this situation and not sitting here and waiting for something to happen and then reacting after the fact. Thank you.
Thank you, Kurt Stremberg. I'm sorry, we're having comments. So did you wish to respond to Mr. Stremberg's?
No, just in general, I don't think this isn't a discussion of whether or not we want to bring it forward. This is a discussion whether it's going to be on today or 2 weeks from now for a full board to discuss. There's no discussion about bringing it forward. We're all, I believe, wanting to push it forward. Just want to make that perfectly clear.
Okay, and we understand, and the issue is coming because of exigency, because of the perception. Yours is one opinion. Supervisor Berkowitz has another as to how things are moving in Sacramento and how things are prioritized, whether we have a congressman who's put this on his list to do things with our new administration. These are all things that are moving at really light speed as we speak. Are there any other comments from the audience at this time? Donald, Ms. Westfall, you had your hand up first, and then afterward you'll come up. Thank you.
Donna Westphal, I live in the city, and just as a moment of levity, I'd like to wish everyone a happy Valentine's Day.
Thank you.
All right, last chance grade, talking about whether to have it on today's agenda. I call this one, some supervisors are clueless or ignorant. Because if I just learned today that this is the last day you can put it on the California legislature, and Supervisor Cowan is telling me that she did her homework in calling the feds in Washington, D.C., but I understand Berkowitz says it's Today's the last day we can put it on the California legislature. This is a no-brainer to me. Last chance grade is due to fall into the ocean. It behooves us, or rather this Board of Supervisors, to act upon a Berkowitz plan so it can be submitted to Sacramento. Doesn't make a lick of sense to me to hold off this discussion until Chair Chris Howard is present. And now you do know that something can be done today instead of just continuing to give lip service to this horrible problem. Thank you.
Good. Okay. Please come up, identify yourself, city or county.
Linda Sutter, 5th District. Do you have your plan with you today, Rob? Okay.
I do.
That's great. Then I would like to hear the plan, and I think that we should move forward. And Ms. Cowan, I appreciate that you did some research on that, but you know, it doesn't hurt to discuss it and move forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other comments from the audience on this discussion item, this exigent item to place on the calendar today? Seeing none, we'll close public comments. We'll bring it back to the board. Colleagues?
Thank you. One thing that's been brought up by Supervisor Cowan, rightly so, is that this should be heard by a 5-member board if possible. Of course, that's not possible today. We don't know if it's possible 2 weeks from now, or 4 weeks from now, or next year, because we can't predict whether we're going to have a 5-member board 2 weeks from now. It's possible, but we don't know. One of the supervisors could get sick. Let's assume that we're in the same position 2 weeks from now where we are right now, a 4-member board. Are we going to say, wait a minute, we're not going to hear this plan until we have a 5-member board? How long are we going to sit on this? How long are we going to wait until someone else comes up with a solution for Del Norte County? We've been waiting 40 years for this. Has anyone ever come up with a financing solution for Del Norte County? No. This is the first time that at least we're going to be proactive about our own future. Can anyone deny that we need a financing plan? No. Well, why don't we just hear that today? And let's make a decision today.
Thank you, Supervisor Berkowitz. Supervisor Hamilton?
Yeah, I think there's a process that needs to be followed, and I don't disagree. So I think Supervisor Cowan makes some really good points. It's the urgency of last chance grade is on our minds constantly, or at least it's on my mind constantly, and every time I meet with any legislative group or person, last chance grade is usually the first thing that comes out of my mouth. So it's not like it's off the table, but I think this, normally when something comes on the agenda, we would have the paperwork to go along with this plan. For us to discuss a plan that we haven't even been able to read, I think is something that I'm certainly not in favor of. I don't know what this plan, I'm guessing that it must be a shovel-ready plan because that is what the president is asking for his $1 trillion. He wants shovel-ready plans of infrastructure. So I'm guessing this is a pretty large document that we need to look at. So I don't feel comfortable in going over a plan, if we have one, at this time. I would like to see it. I would like to see the body of the plan.
Supervisor Cowan.
And have time to research and look at it.
Okay. I understand. Did you have a comment? No. All right, I'm going to say this. We're a board of 5, and we need a quorum of 3 to do business in Del Norte County. I think I've missed 3 meetings in 4 years. I don't think anything stopped because I missed a meeting. Our chairman, his position is he sets the agenda, which in this case was omitted, and he also proceeds over this meeting, which I'm doing today as vice chair. I think his vote is 1/5 of whatever it is here today. So the exigency of this matter, I think, trumps, if I may use that word, the overall issue of whether this board needs to hear this issue today. And I am in favor of hearing about it today. Now, certainly, Supervisors Cowan and Supervisors Hemmington, you have a vote. You can vote. If you choose you're not comfortable with it, you can abstain. And we all know the rule on what we'll need to move forward on this, to have this on the agenda today. So at this time, I will ask for the vote. Kylie, if you would, please.
Supervisor Cowan?
No.
Supervisor Hemmington?
No.
Supervisor Berkowitz?
Yes.
Vice Chair Gitlin?
Yes. All right. The motion fails to place it on the agenda today. It will be placed on the agenda, I presume, by our chair when he returns on the 28th, and I hope he's here, because if he's not here, then I guess we'll have to delay that again. So I'm hopeful that all five of us will be here on February 28th to hear this. Now, we have another matter, but I think what I'm going to do now, since it is 10:27, is I'm going to go to public comments. This is the comment period where anything that is not on the agenda, members of the public may address the board on matters which are within the jurisdiction of the board. If you are addressing the board regarding a matter listed on the agenda, you may be asked to hold your comments until the board takes up the matter. Please limit your comments to 3 minutes or less. So let's see who wishes to approach the dais. Please identify yourself and whether you live in the city or the county, and you have 3 minutes.
Sharon McKinney, 50-year resident of the county. I'd like to thank Supervisor Hemmington for remembering about Cooper and Jay. Before Cooper Street was closed to pedestrians, I was walking up the hill, and there at the top was Heidi, Mr. Barnes, a city employee, and a man in a suit. And they invited me into the conversation about the intersection. And they asked me if I had any input, and I said, one thing I'd like to see is move that 30-mile-an-hour speed limit sign down to the bottom of the hill, because when people are going by at 45, they don't notice it. And the city guy said that could be done. And then I was curious about why uphill traffic on J Street is stopped when the law says uphill traffic has the right-of-way, and the eastbound Cooper Street is open. They don't have any stop sign. If there was to be a stop sign on eastbound Cooper Street back by the fire hydrant, then that would be a good place for the crosswalk, because then people coming up the hill at a reasonable rate of speed would have a chance to see the pedestrians. Anyway, I wanted to thank you very much for remembering that. And by the way, Supervisor Gitlin, that out of code fence at 1061 is still a neighborhood blight. Thank you.
Okay, any other comments from the audience? To identify yourself, Norma.
Good morning. I'm Norma Williams, Chapter President of the Del Norte County Employees Association, SEIU 10-1. As you can see, I have some of our county employees here today, just basically wanting to send a message to each and every single one of you while we are at this critical stage of negotiations, to have a heart, to think about your county employees, the low wages that we are working under, the now acknowledged by your county team recruitment and retention problem as a result of our low wages, and also to remind you that as a result there was a salary study conducted, negotiated in good faith and paid for by the taxpayers of this county, that clearly shows that county employees are underpaid but anywhere between 11% to 16% against the 10 comparable counties that the study was done against. But we also want to remind you that the low wages is the reason, the primary reason why there is a recruitment and retention problem here in Del Norte County. By keeping the wages low, you lower the bar in terms of the services that we provide and the people that we serve. You have to understand that if we are able to pay better wages, offer better benefits, We are then able to retain the quality staff that you have now, the dedicated staff that you now have here throughout the county, but you're also able to recruit more, thereby increasing the services that we provide and expanding the client base, the community base. And therefore, and quite frankly, you're then able to not let anyone be left behind. No one falls through the cracks. And that's the one thing that we are definitely wanting to remind you of. So on this special day of Valentine's Day, which we wish all of you and yours a happy Valentine's, have a heart and think about your county employees. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Thank you very much, Norma. Are there any other public comments at this time? Please identify yourself.
Good morning. My name is Donna Wheeler. I am a member of SEIU 1021 as well. I've been an employee for going on 11 years, and I do want to say thank you all for all of your hard work. I know that you guys care because it takes a special person to work in Del Norte County, work with the public. I've done it, and I know you guys all care as well. And I just ask that that you try to resolve the issues so that we can have a contract, so that we can have a fair contract. All the years that I've been working here, I've been proud of Del Norte County. I've been proud that we work together, we come to resolutions, and I would just want you guys to see the urgency in the fact that we don't have a contract right now, and it is very important. I just ask for you all to be fair and respect that urgency of getting us a contract. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other public comments at this time? Okay. Ms. Sutter, go ahead. You've identified yourself.
I'm going to try to talk.
Okay.
Linda Sutter, 5th District. First, on behalf of the SEIU, if the county gave the animal control people 17% raise, it's my understanding, I could be wrong about that, then I think 9% is pretty reasonable. Secondly, I noticed that during the last board meeting that specific agenda items were pulled for discussion, but it wasn't offered to the public to speak on any of the agenda items that were not pulled. And during a 2x2 meeting, I noticed that there was no on the agenda, there was public comment posted on the agenda, but it was not opened for public agenda. So I kind of would like to see that in the future. If there's agenda items that someone wants to discuss, at least have the opportunity to, because I know Mr. Hemmingson in the past has opened up agenda items for public comment. So that's all.
Thank you very much, Ms. Sutter. With regard to that statement, it's always good. I always like to know, as you know, I do pull a number of items from the consent agenda. But if you have an issue that wishes to be pulled, and any member of the public, please address your supervisor in your district and have them pull that item for discussion, and that'll give you a more transparent view, if that's okay with you. Are there any other additional comments at this time? If you will, come on up.
Hello, my name is Tracy Merrifield. I'm also a member of Del Norte Local 1021. I've lived in Del Norte County for 21 years now. I left to get my bachelor's degree and then came back, and now I've worked for the Department of Health and Human Services for 11 years. And it's really hard for me knowing that I could make more if I decided to move to another county to get a job, but I want to stay here in this community. And just, you know, I want you guys to realize how hard it is making ends meet with our low wages. So just was, you know, wanting to talk to you guys.
Okay, thank you very much. Any additional public comments? Vicki, if you'd identify yourself and where you were in the county or the city.
Yep, it's me. Victoria Dickey. I live in Bob Berkowitz District.
District 5.
first comment is there are several of us who have thought seriously about moving out of the area because of the hospital, because of wages. I like to add that we can't. The road's falling off. We can't get away. So maybe that's why we shouldn't fix the road. Seriously, last grant's grade is such a major issue that looms over us. When will Chris Howard be back in town? Does anybody know?
Yes.
When? Can I ask?
Let me not interrupt your comments. So finish your comments, and then we'll address your...
Okay. My thought is that I'm going to pretend he's going to be here Friday. Could there not be a special meeting convened for Friday? Couldn't you put something on the agenda where you guys get together? It can be open. It has to be open because it's a Brown Act thing. And schedule for that just to go over this plan, not necessarily to vote on anything, but so you get all of these papers in front of you. You guys can sit there and yell at each other about whether a comma goes before or after, but you'll have a basis to start from because the goal of everyone is the same. It's the details that, you know, your how do we get from here to there? And so if you could schedule, say, one, I don't care if you schedule two special meetings so that by 2 weeks from today, you're ready to go forward with a vote. You may even schedule it, and you may know when you're in the first meeting talking about the details what you know, you want to do even at the next meeting. You can have, it's okay with me. I know I employ you. So you guys can meet as many times as it takes to deal with this issue. And I know that everyone is concerned. So that just a thought.
Thank you, Ms. Dickey. Let's just respond to Ms. Dickey's comments. The idea of calling for a special meeting on this subject, Jay, I'm going to defer to you. Is that in my role as the vice chair to hold a special meeting, ask for a special meeting, and get a consensus of our board to appear, knowing that Chris Howard is back in the county on a date unknown to me?
Yeah, I think that's an action that can be taken by the Board of Supervisors. Obviously, you want to see what the availability of the other board members are in order to get a quorum.
Okay, and we're going to take that position. Do we know when Chris is back here and give jet lag notwithstanding?
I don't have his schedule, no.
Okay, so let's just play this out a little bit. Friday is a holiday, of course, and if I'm not mistaken, so is Monday.
Yeah.
So the earliest it could be conducted would be a Tuesday or a Wednesday to hear about the Great American Plan. So that's a week delay. Members of this board, are you open to having a special meeting at a time convenient to all parties here to have this plan put before, which we've asked for? And however thick or thin it is, are you willing to meet at that time? I'll open it up to our board.
Supervisor Gitlin, I'm ready to meet any time that this board feels necessary.
Okay, let me do this before we move on. I need to do the closing. Are there any more public comments? You've already spoken, Ms. Westfall, so you had your 3 minutes. Are there any more public comments in the 10:25 public comment period, not on this subject? Any more public comments on this? Okay, I'm going to close public comments at this time. Then I'm going to review and revisit our board to see if they're open to attending a special meeting on, let's say, Tuesday or Wednesday of next week. Take out our iPads and see if, are you all amenable to meeting at that time to discuss the Great American Plan?
I'm open to discuss. I don't have my calendar in front of me, so we would make it work if Kylie could get us all together.
Okay. That would be Jerry. What's your feeling on this?
Yeah, I'd like to see the plan. I've got no problem with looking at the plan.
Okay, I will ask.
I don't know that this is, you know, normally the chairman sets the meetings, and if it's a special meeting, we're not always. I mean, it's always nice to get to make sure we're available. I am available on Tuesday.
Tuesday the 21st?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'm also available on Tuesday the 21st.
Okay. As am I. And Ms. Cowan, you're not sure at this point, Tuesday the 21st, and we don't know about Chris. But we're going to go on the premise that I believe there's a Solid Waste Authority meeting here at 1 o'clock. So I'm going to ask that, well, if that's the case, and if Chair Howard indicated he's a member of the Solid Waste Authority, he would be at that meeting, then perhaps we can schedule a special meeting at this time to discuss one item, and one item only, the Great American Plan. CAO Serena?
You would want to make that request of the Clerk of the Board. And then she would agendize that properly with the correct amount of time and put that together.
Kylie, would you do so? Do one of those little doodle things? I'm not quite sure what you call it. Yeah. Okay. All right, so we'll talk about that, and we'll hear back from you accordingly. Okay, let's see where we're at. We are now closing as a public comment period is closing. We'll move on to the 10:30 item, timed item, which is to hold a public meeting, waive full reading, and introduce by title only an ordinance amending coastal zoning map C8, which is Tedson Lane. Rezone, it's the APN, is 110-415, as requested by the Assistant Director of Community Development, Randy Hooper. Tell us what this is all about.
Supervisor Yellen, members of the board, good morning. So this item before you is the consideration of a proposed rezoning of a portion of a parcel at the end of Tedson Lane. Currently, the property is zoned both RRA1 and RCA1. The parcel in question is an undeveloped 1.25-acre parcel, which is owned by the applicant, Pambro Forest Products Incorporated. The objective of this application is to define the RCA portions of the parcel more clearly so that the property may be marketed accurately and later sold and developed. Prior to the development being able to be authorized on this parcel, the RCA area has to be rezoned. That's pursuant to the county's adopted local coastal program, or the LCP. The LCP was certified in the early 80s and includes provisions in which environmentally sensitive habitat areas were initially classified, and this resulted in the approximate designation of these general RCA areas or RCA 1 areas. The LCP also stipulates a process by which a general RCA area could be rezoned based on further study of the resource. This would include mapping, biological assessment, consultation with the California Department and Fish and Wildlife. And the result of the RCA rezoning process would be that the general resource RCA area would then be a designated RCA 2 resource area. In this particular case, the project abuts the outskirts of Lake Earl and is proposed to be reclassified into a designated RCA 2 wetland and RCA 2 wetland buffer in the areas appropriate. Portions of the project would also retain the existing RRA1 zoning outside of those RCA areas. The Planning Commission did review the application, which included obviously supporting materials, biological assessment, wetland delineation, and so forth, and recommended that the board approve the application and then transmit evidence of the board's approval to the Coastal Commission for certification. As part of the county's review of the application, staff prepared what's called an initial study that resulted in the posting of a negative declaration that indicates no environmental impacts associated with approval of the application. Through that CEQA review process, no comments were received. The Planning Commission also conducted a public hearing for the neighbors in the Tedson Lane area, and if I recall correctly, I don't believe we received any comments through that process either. This public hearing is necessary to introduce this project to the board, as well as to solicit public comment. The item must return back to the board for adoption of the ordinance, as well as approval of the resolution, which would then authorize transmittal of the approval to the Coastal Commission for certification, as I mentioned. That all has to happen before the project can be considered final. So at this time, my recommendation would be that the board open the public hearing, solicit public comment, and then direct staff to return the item back to the board for a subsequent meeting at which it can be acted upon.
So there's no board action per se?
Correct.
Okay, so we'll open it up now to the public. anyone wishing to, and we're going to go back to the board afterward for additional questions. Does anyone from the public wish to come up and make a statement, ask a question of Mr. Hooper on this proposed ordinance? Seeing that, we'll close the public comment and bring it back to the board. Are there members of the board who wish to make a statement or ask a question of Mr. Hooper with regard to this ordinance? Okay, so then at this point, public hearing is open, and we'll move forward and we'll expect to hear back from you. No further action is necessary. Is that correct, Mr. Hooper? That's right. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, let's move back to items on the agenda. And I guess we will move now to receive brief reports or announcements relative to the County of Del Norte programs and projects, progress of other two by two committees, goal committees, and or board and staff traveling, training reports, etc. And at this point, I will ask for Supervisor Cowan to make her report.
Thank you, Supervisor Gitlin. I attended my first Barrow Boys Ranch committee meeting. Things are going along there. I also attended the fair dinner. That was a huge turnout. They acknowledged Randy Hatfield for being the 69th inductee to the Western Fair Association Hall of Fame. I thought that was great. A good accomplishment for him that should be acknowledged. Also, Paula Sturtevant received the 2016 Volunteer of the Year Award with all the work that she does over at the fair, and especially with the kids. I met with Jack and Heather Snow to get kind of caught up on mental health. It was a good meeting. I also had a really good meeting with Sheriff Apperson, just discussing many items in the county, both good and bad. This is another one. I attended the Realtors Dinner, and I point this out. I want to point out the people that took awards. Donna Zorn was recognized as the top producer. Josh Clemens, Realtor of the Year. Kevin Hawkins and Caitlin got the Rising Star Awards. I point this out because these are the people in our community, the professionals that sell this community. Every day as a realtor, they have to look at everything around us, from hospitals to schools, and sell that to the people that we want to come here. So they do a really good job at that. I attended my first mental health meeting. I also met with Rachel Mylar from Building Healthy Communities, and with Jeff Harrison from the school district, just to further discuss the healthcare initiative that's being brought forward by BHC. This has been an ongoing process for me. We've been working on it for a while. The school district is now developing a position specifically for this health career pathway, which is very, very exciting. I'm a strong believer in home growing, you know, taking our kids, educating them, and bringing them home. This is where they want to be. You heard that from employees. They come home. They want to be here. And we need to create jobs to make sure that they can come back and earn a living. Finally, I had a meeting yesterday. Oh, not finally. I also, last week, was at the CSAC Institute. It was my second session. It was very informative. I find that CSAC is a great resource for all of us, and I find it a great, a good opportunity for me to engage with all the other supervisors from the 50 counties and find out what's going on with all of them. And I look forward to my next session in April. And then finally, I had a meeting with Ted Ward, the Director of Solid Waste. That's gonna be one of my new committees. And he was very gracious in giving me the complete history of the authority yesterday and bringing me up to date and getting me prepared for next week's meeting. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Supervisor Hamilton.
Yes, thank you. I had a few things going on. Had a meeting with staff and Fish and Wildlife representative about some fishing access lands that are within the county that the county manages, and we're trying to work out some agreements there. That's an ongoing conversation. Had a Resource Conservation District meeting that I went to. Met with the lily bulb growers over some issues. As Supervisor Cowan had stated, we had a Borrow Oversight Committee meeting. Had a meeting in Chico with the NORTEC group, which is the Northern Rural Training and Employment Consortium. Went to the chamber dinner, which is always very nice. We had a Natural Resources Goal Committee meeting, had a meeting with staff over some Pacific Shores issues and working on a possible plan that I'll bring back to the board at some point. Had a conference call with our whale entanglement group, had a conversation with a representative of the Nature Conservancy regarding Dungeness crab trap retrieval program. Also was notified, I don't remember exactly what day it was, I think maybe it was Friday, it was informed that during our highest water flows that the Bureau of Reclamation had decided that they were going to double or more than double the output out of Iron Gate Dam. Seems to be that they were concerned about what was going into the lake, but not concerned much about what was going out. So that was very concerning. I made some calls to Ray Hupp, supervisor of Siskiyou County. He was working on that, was not readily available at that point. So I went on to call Brenda Hayes out of Congressman LaMalfa's office, as well as John Driscoll from Congressman Huffman's office, to just to let them know that we were not notified of these releases, and we were already having issues on the Klamath River with high waters, and it's kind of irresponsible for them not to at least let us know that that's what they were doing. Later that day, Ray got back to me and said that he had gotten the releases stopped for the time being, which we again were not notified. So once we found out that the releases were supposed to happen, so we're trying to make preparations for that, and then find out that, oh, wait a minute, no, now they're not going to release the water. So for them not to notify us, I think it was fairly irresponsible. And I let both Huffman's office and LaMalfa's office know that. And hopefully we can have a better relationship with the Bureau of Reclamation. That was it for me.
Thank you, Supervisor. Supervisor Berkowitz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Last Wednesday and Thursday, I met with Assemblyman Wood and Senator McGuire in Sacramento. I emphasized the importance of their support for federal dollars to fund the replacement for Last Chance Grade. And of course, this was in conjunction with the new supervisor training put on by CSAC, which of course, both Supervisor Cowan and I attended. I had to rush home early, however, on Friday. We left very early in the morning so that we could get to Klamath to see what kinds of help that they needed. Luckily, at that time, the water had not rushed over Highway 101, but I did meet with Aaron Funk of Camp Klamath, and I posted some of the pictures on Facebook, and you'll notice that the playground now, instead of being in a field, is now in the middle of the Klamath River. So the water definitely was extremely high, and I met with a number of people who were in danger and working on the problems that they had. Since the last board meeting, I had a one-on-one conference with Chairman O'Rourke of the Yurok Tribe concerning problems of cross-deputization of the tribal members with the Del Norte County Sheriff's Department. And of course, we discussed Last Chance Grade and turning over the ball fields to the Yurok Tribe. I also attended the Fairgrounds Appreciation Dinner in Crescent City with the also with the Crescent City Del Norte Awards Dinner from the Chamber of Commerce. And you'll note that I will be the Chamber's or the Board's representative on the Chamber Board. So I continue to hold daily informal town hall meetings every morning at 6 a.m. By the way, those meetings will be moved to the Apple Peddler restaurant starting tomorrow due to the fact that the Fisherman restaurant is closing down for remodeling for the next couple of weeks. So any of you would like to join me at 6 a.m. at the Apple Peddler, you're free to do so.
Thank you, Supervisor Berkowitz. Well, indeed, I too had a busy 2.5 week period since our last meeting. I attended the Del Norte County Fair Appreciation Dinner and was pleased to see Fair Manager Randy Hatfield honored by the Western Association of Fairs in Reno. Afterwards, Supervisor Berkowitz and I met with the Fair Board to actually ask some questions and learn some details of the strategic plan Now, that has to do with where our quarter cent sales tax is going and how soon it can be implemented. And I'm expecting that the Fair Board will be making a request to appear before the Board of Supervisors to give details of the strategic plan since the sales tax was passed, I believe, 17 months ago. So, and that by a two-thirds vote. The Redwood Coast Transit Authority met. Nothing to report from our last meeting. We elected some new chair and vice chair. Also, Angie and I attended the Chamber of Commerce dinner. Participated in our bi-monthly Lions Club cleanup along Highway 101, and on the subject of blight, which is near and dear to my heart. I'm very happy to say some Tick-A-Bite out of Blight volunteers covered up a long-standing graffiti vandalized vacant home. It's actually a church. I won't give the exact street a name, but I will tell you that it gives me great pride to see that this graffiti, which is severely tagged for all these years, is now gone. And it's a nice little blue house. So shouldn't have even said that, but there you go. And we're removing, and these are anonymous volunteers who selflessly devote their time and funds to help remove blight from Del Norte County. Also met last week with Phoebe Ellenhart, coordinator of the Del Norte Reads program, operating through the county library. Del Norte Reads is a family literacy service. There are currently 37 students tutored by 11 tutors, and there are 4 ESL classes, one in Smith River, and Phoebe Ellenhart will be making a presentation before our board on literacy reads in April. City Councilman Alex Fallman and I met with the new property management at the Jedediah Smith Center. The center has a quasi-new membership. Mr. Berger passed away, and his children have now taken over, and it is literally night and day in terms of receptive, what they wish to do and how they wish to improve the quality of life at that center. And it will be cleaned up, and ownership is investigated in a number of different avenues to welcome the valuable customer who patronizes the center and promises to demand no loitering ordinance be enforced. This is a very promising news, and I offer local management any assistance I can provide to them to provide higher quality of life at the Jedediah Smith Center. The Pelican Bay State Advisory Board met for its quarterly meeting. Warden Dukart and his staff announced the need for between 50 and 60 new corrections officers. As you know, one of the two SHUs, secured housing unit, has closed down. So they're estimated there are going to be about 480 new beds put in the old D unit SHU, and this will house level 2 life inmates in this security housing unit, which is now not called a SHU. The warden also spoke of some new rehabilitation programs designed to mainstream inmates back into our communities. I'm not going to mince my words. I have some reservations about some of these programs, but most of them are well-intentioned, and some of them are quite excellent. But like it or not, inmates are coming out of CDCR, and they're coming back into the community, as it was pointed out to me. So let's get them prepared. And so on the agenda this morning, Warden Dukart is actually welcoming our board letter, which has yet to be approved on, for asking for re-implementation of the Level 1 work program, and there are currently 120 inmates in the Level 1 work unit. And this was originally provided by the Pelican Bay State Prison back when it opened in 1989, and the warden said he supports it. He feels it provides a valuable community service, both for the community and the inmate, and this is at no cost. That's the request, at no cost to Del Norte County. And finally, congratulations to Walmart Store 1910 in Crescent City for locking up its hard liquor. I was privileged to work with Sheriff Apperson and County Office of Education Superintendent Jeff Harris when we met with Walmart General Manager Peter Davis and suggested he consider securing his hard liquor because he agreed. And he says that due to the high pilferage rate and liquor ending up in the hands of irresponsible adults being shoplifted and minors, those security measures were put in. So my hope is, or hope in the community, that other city retailers will follow suit and join Walmart in securing its hard liquor inventory, just like cigarettes, just like cosmetics, and just like jewelry. And that is my report, so we will now move on to a report from CAO Serena. Jake?
Okay, I wasn't listed, but I'll report out. Been working on a number of different issues and items. Had long discussions with our public defenders over some issues within the staffing of the public defense contract. I think the board's aware that we provide public defense through a contract. So we'll be working closely with them and the courts in order to get full staffing for that. I've met with numerous departments over issues within their departments that they've asked for assistance on. Have been doing individual employee evaluations that are coming due. Have sat on a couple of the an interview panel, and also have been involved in the committees that have been previously reported, the Borrow Committee and the Natural Resources Committee. Have been talking very closely with Senator McGuire, and have had a conference call with Senator McGuire and HCD staff regarding West Park properties, and have been dealing with some of the OES issues that have popped up over the last couple of storms. And just to kind of elaborate on Supervisor Berkowitz's, comments regarding Klamath, there will be assessments done in regards to damage and or additional work that has to be done through overtime in regards to coming forward with any kind of a declaration for Del Mar County. We did declare in December. We didn't have damage on the January storm. That appears there was going to be reimbursable costs associated with this one. We prepared about 24 hours in advance and started to discuss actions by operations, which was search and rescue, Klamath Fire, Sheriff's Department, in order to, and the road department, in order to put people in the proper areas to assist the people of Klamath in case some of the roads became impassable. We had some issues in regards to some of the projections, and I'm not pointing fingers at anybody because they're simply projections, but originally the river was set at over 42 feet, then the next projection came in at under 40 feet, and then it came back again at 42 feet. So I would like to thank those that were out there most of the night and out working. There was a search and rescue that happened. I believe the people were on the Rezegini side of the river, and search and rescue, and I think the sheriff's office, boating and safety, went across and picked those two people up and brought them back across. So as we go through these, there are a number of people, partners, and the Department of the Office of Emergency Services that activate in advance to make sure that we have people in the proper place. Obviously, with flooding, we sit and wait because the river decides what the damage is going to be. And fortunately, 101 did not get covered in this case, which is always nice. But there were people affected. And in regards to the statement by Supervisor Hemmingson in regards to the releases out of Iron Gate, I would just mention to the board that it would be my goal to get a letter to the Bureau of Reclamation as soon as we can, getting them to understand that the people that are downstream are affected by their actions upstream, and they shouldn't ignore the individual counties. Siskiyou County was involved in that also, as the supervisor mentioned. Pacific Power was also a source on that. I was in touch with Monty Mendenhall. He showed me almost immediately what the judge's order was that gave the Bureau of Reclamation the order to go out and do releases in order to assist with fisheries up in the upper Klamath Lake. Unfortunately, they didn't take into account that the river was at flood stage just a few hours before that. And luckily, it was receding in such a way that Del Mar County likely would not have been affected, but they didn't even take it into account. So we'll be addressing that and get them to notify us before they do any of those actions.
Jay, I have a couple questions. First of all, would number one, would you make sure that letter to the reclamation is put on the next agenda for the board to see, and that's on the 28th. Secondly, I'm not sure what it is, but maybe Supervisor Berkowitz or Jay, you can tell us, what is the crest level at Klamath River? I've heard 47, I've heard 50 feet. I'm not sure. What is, do you know what the number is?
The effect when the Highway 101 is topped is just over 42 feet, okay. Almost 43 feet. There are effects in the 30-foot range in regards to some of the other local roads. I believe 169 had half of a lane covered in water. Obviously, East Klamath Beach Road is a much lower level in regards to flooding on the Rezegini. But there are different levels that they'll show you. If you go to the National Weather Service and you look at the river levels specific for the Klamath, there's a gauge on the lower Klamath. Down below that, they break that down by elevation based on historical events. Obviously, the 64 event is sitting at the top of that. That is basically widespread devastation throughout the Klamath area, and it drops down from there. But it does give you an understanding of those historical water levels and what is affected at that point.
Thank you for that explanation. All right, let's go back to Supervisor Berkowitz. You had a second request to add an item to the agenda as an exigent item. Would you repeat that again so that we can see about considering putting that on the agenda? And if it would be, it's probably at Area 30, so I understand it.
This is a resolution that would come from the Board of Supervisors declaring that Del Norte County complies with federal immigration laws and does not constitute a sanctuary jurisdiction. As you know, SB 54 basically declares the state as a sanctuary state, which of course would encompass Del Norte County. And the main body, of course, that was already on the agenda is a rejection of SB 54. And this is a resolution that goes along with that, that states the position of Del Norte County in vis-a-vis a sanctuary state.
So essentially this is giving direction to staff and to opining in with the state. They're asking for our opinion.
Correct.
On SB 54, which is part of 30. Now, Council Cable, do we need a separate consensus on this to have this matter put forth, or is this part of just the discussion of 30?
Since it's an action item, the passage of a resolution, it would need to be added as an urgency item, and I already gave the definition earlier today. On how that would be done. And I would have some of the same concerns, but I would leave the factual about whether or not it came up prior to the posting of the agenda up to you all to discuss.
All right, we'll move forward. Is that in the form of a motion, Supervisor Berkowitz?
Yes, it is.
Okay, do we have a second to that? I'll second it. Okay, so at that point we have a motion and we have a second to add this item. Kylie, do you have the actual resolution?
Yes, I do.
Okay, it's not terribly long. You can distribute that. Thank you. And if you would, Mr. Supervisor Berkowitz, you'd make sure that our council and Serena, CAO Serena, gets copies
sure.
of that. So I'm going to defer to you at this point to basically read the motion, read the resolution. It's not that long, and have the public opine in on it.
Okay. Sure. So this consists of several whereas clauses, and I'll read them. Whereas the County of Del Norte respects both the rights of immigrant communities and the authority of the United States government to regulate immigration. And whereas the term sanctuary jurisdiction, it has historically been applied to those governments who deliberately refuse to comply with federal immigration laws as a result of local policy decisions by that jurisdiction elected with the intention of hindering enforcement of those laws. Whereas federal law 8 U.S.C. 1373 and 1644 provides that no government entity may prohibit or restrict its officials from sending to or receiving from United States immigration authorities information regarding the citizenship or of immigration status of any individual. And whereas, in addition to the foregoing mandate of legal obligations, United States immigration authorities often request additional voluntary assistance from local governments and law enforcement agencies, including requests to hold individuals in custody known as immigration detainers. And whereas such voluntary assistance is largely unreimbursed by the federal government, and with all requests for interagency aid, local governments, law enforcement agencies with limited resources are often forced to make difficult decisions regarding whether assistance can be provided on a case-by-case basis, including considerations of funding, personnel availability, jail capacity, and other obligations. Therefore, now it be it resolved that the County of Del Norte, acting by and through the Del Norte County Board of Supervisors, hereby declares that the County of Del Norte complies with federal immigration laws 8 U.S.C. 1373 and 1644 and does not prohibit or restrict officials, employees, or other persons from sending to or receiving from United States immigration authorities information regarding the citizenship or immigration status of any individual. Be it further resolved that the County of Del Norte, acting by and through the Del Norte County Board of Supervisors, hereby declares that it does not refuse to comply with federal immigration laws as a result of any local policy decisions by county elected officials, and does not have any intention of hindering enforcement of those laws, and does not meet any reasonable definition of a sanctuary jurisdiction. Be it further resolved that the County of Del Norte will at all times endeavor to provide appropriate interagency assistance to the United States immigration authorities within the limits of its resources, including funding, personnel availability, jail capacity, and other legal obligations. Be it further resolved that the United States Congress, federal administration, and other appropriate agencies of the federal government are hereby urged to include representatives of rural local governments in California and nationwide the process of developing any legal definition of sanctuary jurisdiction. There's only three more resolves. Be it further resolved that the United States Congress, federal administration, and other appropriate agencies of the federal government are hereby urged not to reduce, restrict, or eliminate any federal funding to local governments of the sole basis that such governments are sometimes unable to provide voluntary assistance to the United States immigration authorities due to resource limitations as described above. Be it further resolved that the United States Congress, federal administration, and other appropriate agencies of the federal government are hereby urged to provide local governments with the full cost reimbursement for any assistance requested by and rendered to the United States immigration authorities. Be it further resolved that the California legislature, governor, and appropriate state agencies are hereby urged to adopt legislation, regulations, and policies applicable to local governments that adhere to federal law and are consistent with the authority of the United States government to regulate immigration.
I'll finish that off, Supervisor. So the foregoing resolution was offered by your motion, Supervisor Berkowitz, seconded by me, Supervisor Gitlin, and we will now open this up for discussion to the public before we bring it back to the board. those of you who wish to come up and give us an opinion on this. There may be some extra copies of the resolution. Go ahead, Donna.
Donna Westfall. I live in the city, and this is a letter from the Crescent City Del Norte County Taxpayers Association dated February 13th, 2017. To the Del Norte County Board of Supervisors regarding Senate Bill 54, turning California into a sanctuary state. Many of our ancestors came to this country legally through Ellis Island. The majority of our board of directors in a 7-to-1 vote finds it hard to understand why there would be immigration laws that anyone can choose to break and not be subject to any consequences. We see undocumented workers take advantage of our social and welfare services, put a drain on our economic system, commit violent acts, and then be free of worry from Federal Immigration and Customs Enforcement, ICE. We stand with the California State Sheriff's Association in opposing this bill, and we therefore urge this Board of Supervisors to stand up to the legislatures that want to turn our state into a free-for-all and tell them to vote no on SB 54. Please make this letter a part of the public record. Respectfully, Jackie Simonson, Secretary.
Are there any additional comments? Anybody else in the audience wishes to address? Please come up.
My name is Lonnie Raymond. I'm a resident in Supervisor Howard's district. I'd like to I have no standing before this board, but I would like to caution you and raise a point of order. This item is not on the agenda. What you've done at this point is put forward a motion to place it on the agenda, and the poli-sci major in me, I'm forced to say that the discussion of this item in this context is not appropriate. You must first put it on the agenda so the citizens of this county have an opportunity to see what it is that you want to bring forward as our representatives and in our voice, and give us the opportunity in the proper context to address this issue. Thank you.
And again, I don't mean to echo Ms. Our counsel, Liz Cables. She's already mentioned that. That's what this is right now about, putting it on the item as part of discussion item number 30. So this is part of that discussion. It's part of what's called input. So it's not a terribly long document, and it's something that can be digested as we speak here by this board, and that would be my response to Mr. Raymond. So any other comments from, did anyone else wish to come up to the dais and offer a comment on this, adding this to the item 30 discussion?
For today?
Yes, it's item 30 on the agenda. Let me read item 30. Discuss and give direction to staff regarding Senate Bill 54, California's Act, as requested by this County Administrative Officer. Okay. Now, as a result of that, this is part of that discussion. So we're asking that, this is input, we're asking that this resolution, giving our opinion of this Senate Bill 54, be included in today's discussion. So identify yourself and give us your opinion.
I'm not going to talk about it right now. I'll write about it.
Victoria Dickey, Bob Berkowitz District. One of the things I noticed recently was Jerry Brown has been saying, Trump's not my president. He's been saying, we are a sanctuary state. We want to leave the United States of America. Well, about 3 days ago, call it an act of God, the dam broke. Now, it's kind of a lack of diplomacy to come up and stick somebody in the eye with a stick or a poker and then turn around and say, hey, we want money. We need that road. You guys go around there sticking everybody in the eye with a stick. I don't care what position you are in, whatever the road is you have to travel to say we are not a sanctuary city seems to me to be what you need to do. And if I happen to miss any of the meetings, know that I still don't support sanctuary cities.
But okay, thank you.
That's it.
All right. Any other comments or questions before we close the comment?
Norma Williams, I'm in Lori Cowan's district, District 2. I have to agree with Chief Probation Officer Raymond. I think this is highly inappropriate to just bring this to discussion at this time. I think it needs to be properly given time for not only you, but also staff to take time to review it and also to present it to the public so that we have more appropriate time, actual time to actually review it and comment. As a very proud second-generation Hispanic descendant from Ecuador, I really do believe that this is a highly inappropriate discussion at this time, and I really do ask, actually I plead that you wait and give it the proper time for us, the public, the community, to review this resolution and give the appropriate response at the appropriate time. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes. Recognize Supervisor Berkowitz.
May I suggest that we include this resolution as part of our special meeting that we're going to have?
So that would be item number two, and yeah. I think that's a good suggestion. Mm-hmm. Is there consensus to do that at the as yet unannounced meeting, which was going to be, do we have consensus on that?
I believe there's a motion and a second on the floor.
Yes, there is. So let's do this. Supervisor Berkowitz, are you willing to remove your motion?
I am willing to withdraw the motion.
And I will withdraw my motion to second. So now we're back to this discussion of adding this as a second item at a special meeting. Is that what you're, and you're going to make that motion?
That's correct, and I would make that motion.
Well, I don't know. I think I have the purview under the purview of the board. I can put that on the agenda item for discussion, proper discussion. So those of you who have some concern about vetting this properly, so let's add that as a second item for the proposed February 22nd, 21st meeting, excuse me. Okay. All right. Let us move on now to consent agenda items, and this time I need to read item number five, the 420 DHHS Staff Services Analyst entry should read 420 DHHS Deputy LPS Conservator. All right, now, having said that, I'll now entertain, and I want to do this the right way because I had Ms. Sutter listening to these words, so I'm going to read this on consent agenda. Comments from members of the public may be heard at this time regarding consent agenda on the consent agenda items only. So you have an opportunity to speak to any item on the consent agenda, Ms. Sutter, at this time as we undertake a motion. Or are there any discussion, deleted items, or any other discussion from our board members on the consent agenda? So I will entertain, and I would like to pull off number 17 for discussion and clarity from Department of Health and Human Services. And do any other supervisors have anything else they wish to pull from the consent agenda item at this time? Seeing none, are there comments on the public consent agenda? Please approach. Please identify the number.
Hi, Linda Sutter in 5th District. By the way, I guess, oh my God, are you kidding me? No, no, no. Anyway, okay, so on number 13, okay. You guys want to do a resolution or, let's see, what is it? I don't know. They're going to be receiving $141,000, the Sheriff's Department, for their boarding and waterways division. And when I looked up in the accounting, absolutely, from last year, even this year, there's $0 spent. So I don't know what they're doing with that money. And the thing is it's for educating and enforcing the waterway laws of the public. And we still have an issue down on South Beach. Okay, and maybe that needs to be placed on an agenda for the next meeting coming up. Whether you're going to designate South Beach as a new use area, and if so, you're going to have to go through the environmental impact studies to do that and whatnot else. And to stop this, because right now, jet skis were out in January. I did see Sergeant Burke issuing citations this time. The South Beach is not a designated launch area, according to the local coastal program. You can find that on page 80, because they list the designated launching areas of Del Norte County. And South Beach is not one of them. South Beach is a designated bather's beach. So I don't think you want gasoline on your beaches from the jet skiers filling up with their jet skis. I don't care, one way or the other. Either prohibit the use completely or say, let's go ahead and go forth with making this a new designated area for the jet skiers. But you're going to have to go through the hoops for that. So I don't care which way it is, one way or the other, but please do something. Don't just sit idle, because this is a public safety issue. And I'm formally requesting that it be placed on an agenda item for the next board meeting. Thank you.
Are there any other comments on the consent agenda items only? Please identify the number.
Norma Williams, Chapter President, Del Norte County Employees Association, SEIU 10-1. I just wanted to inquire, was item 20 of the agenda pulled, as requested by the union and union's legal counsel?
I received an email yesterday from union legal counsel, Matt Gauger, that stated the union was not objecting to that number. If the employee was not if it was not an SEIU current employee or an employee of Del Norte County, and that it not be a precedential movement by the union, which I can forward you if you like.
I just wanted to be sure.
I'm going to interrupt this conversation, because this is a separate standalone item, and I don't think it's part of consent agenda.
Actually, I think it was.
I know, but
it is.
Item 20. It is.
If we're going to have a back and forth on this, then it needs to be set aside and properly agendized. I think it's a question about taking it off if one of the supervisors wishes to take it off at this time.
If not, I think your explanation satisfied my inquiry, so thank you.
Okay. All right. Now, I'll entertain any other public comments. We'll close the public comments on the consent agenda, and I'll entertain a motion for consent agenda items, less item number 17, unless any of the supervisors have.
I make a motion to accept the consent agenda minus item 17.
Second.
Okay. Any other further comment? Kylie, if you would call the roll.
Supervisor Hemmingson?
Yes.
Supervisor Cowan?
Yes.
Supervisor Berkowitz?
Yes.
Vice Chair Gitlin?
Yes. Okay, so I pulled out 17. And again, this is, I remember one of your predecessors, Heather, if you can kind of approach, having something similar about AIDS awareness. And I asked the question, this is back in 2013, of former Director Blatnick. How many, and I'll read 17, approve and authorize the chair to sign an agreement with the California Department of Public Health for the HIV surveillance program. It's this contract number for the period July 1st, 2016, it's already begun, and June 30th, 2019, not to exceed, it's a modest amount, $10,640, about $3,500 per year. But at that time, I asked how many AIDS patients or people, and the number was zero. So I said, well, why are we doing this? We don't really have this issue up there. And of course, it passed anyway. So my concern is, do we have people who are suffering from AIDS in our county as we speak right now?
As far as new HIV cases, this is for surveillance only. And it happens that we continue to have a very low number of those cases, 0 to 1 typically.
Okay, so it's a rare thing, and at the same time, it's a surveillance. So my second question would be with regard to this. What is the connection to getting these folks help? I mean, this is a surveillance program. It identifies someone with the AIDS virus, the HIV virus. And I read through the contract, and it's quite long. What is the connection to get these folks who have AIDS, the AIDS virus within them, getting them the appropriate help?
there is other funding for services, and we have a program through our alcohol and other drugs program. We're fortunate that there's not a large population. If we were able to identify through the surveillance that there was an increasing need, which there hasn't been for many years, we could adapt and respond to that.
Okay, it being a very modest number anyway, the amount of money over the next two and a half years, $10,641, if it's not utilized, it simply goes back to the state? Is that my understanding?
No, that funding is actually, it's an allocation based on our population size and our expected workload. So we time study and invoice for our actual work, and then we're reimbursed with that.
Okay, I'm satisfied with your answers. Thank you very much. All right, so let's take the consent agenda items at 17. We'll do that. Take the roll on that, the call on that first, and then we'll do 17 separately.
I think we have to have a motion.
Okay. We think we have a motion. We had a. Did you make
the consent?
Okay. 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 So I'll make that motion, or does another supervisor wish to make that motion, and then I'll.
Go ahead. As,
okay. Jerry.
I'll move.
Okay. Do I have a second on that? 17.
Second.
Okay. All right. Let's call protocol on this. Can we do all together, or do we have to 17 separately? On this,
so you have two separate
okay.
motions right
let's,
now.
Let's do the consent agenda without 17.
That was a question.
Go ahead.
We've already done the
consent agenda. Okay. Consent
agenda is done. All right. Let's go to 17-0s also only.
Supervisor Berkowitz.
Yes.
Supervisor Cowan.
Yes.
Supervisor Hemmingson.
Yes.
Chair Gitlin.
Yes. Okay. Among those three items on the. On two of those, three of the items on consent agenda, and I'll ask, I see we have someone from the engineers here, approve and adopt a proclamation declaring the week of February 19th to February 25th, 2017 as National Engineers Week as requested by Stover Engineering. Supervisor Hemmingson?
Yes, thank you. I'm very happy to be able to read this proclamation. My granddaughter, who was four at the time, was building with her little magnetic blocks, and she was doing an absolutely fantastic job. And I asked her, I said, gee, would you like to be an engineer? And she says, oh, no, absolutely not. And I said, well, do you know what an engineer does? She says, yeah, he drives a train. So with that, she wasn't very interested in being an engineer, but I thought it was very appropriate. So this is a proclamation of Engineers Week, February 19th through the 25th, 2017. Whereas America's engineers transform ideas into reality, solving problems using science and technology to produce services and systems to better serve the needs of society. And whereas engineers serving Delmar County, the state and the county, work to design and construct the following types of projects: airports, roads, railroads, harbors, parks, subdivisions, surveys, bridges, buildings, water systems, flood control facilities, wastewater treatment, seismic safety projects, environmental enhancements. Whereas engineers strive for quality, economy, and the betterment of life of our community, and whereas throughout the nation, the week of February 19th through the 25th, 2017 is being recognized as National Engineers Week, coinciding with George Washington's birthday, our nation's first engineer. Now, therefore, be it resolved that Delmar County, in recognition of the contribution of engineers to society and in an effort to promote the interest of the youth in the community in math, science, and engineering, does hereby declare the week of February 19th, 2017 as Engineers Week in Delmar County on this 14th day of February, 2017.
And on behalf of the engineers, John Olson, would you approach? All right, thank you very much, Mr. Olson. You want to say a couple of words?
My name's John Olson.
That's your two words, you're done? No kidding.
I live in Mr. Hemmingson's district, thank you. And on behalf of, well, I'm a local engineer. I work for Stover Engineering here locally. We've been involved in some of the major projects for both the county and the city recently. But thank you very much for this proclamation on behalf of the American Society of Civil Engineers, of which I'm a member. I thank you.
Sir. Okay. All right, the second one, and there's actually a third one I have circled here, but the approve and adopt a resolution recognize the exemplary service of Mike Marks, retiring from youth group counselor of the Del Norte County Bar O Ranch, as requested by Chief Probation Officer Supervisor Cowan. And I believe we have Lonnie and Kent, and Mr. Marks is here. Nice to meet you, sir.
This is a resolution of the Board of Supervisors of the County of Del Norte, State of California, honoring Mike Marks, retiring youth group counselor. Whereas Mike Marks retired from county service on February 9, 2017, after serving the county of Del Norte County for 26 years. And whereas Mike began his public service in 1991 as a youth group counselor one, eventually promoting to youth group counselor three, and Mike has been one of the most steadfast supporters of the Bar O Boys Ranch program, and whereas Mike has spent countless hours influencing boys in his charge to be successful and encourage positive change in their lives, and whereas Mike has been a role model to innumerable staff and boys, and whereas Mike has been a true cornerstone of the Bar O Boys Ranch program with tireless dedication and contributions, and Mike has been a dedicated county employee whose service will be sorely missed by all that have worked with him, especially around softball season. Must be an inside joke. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Del Norte County Board of Supervisors hereby acknowledges the diligence and dedication Mike Marks has exhibited during his years of service to the County of Del Norte. Be it further resolved that the Board of Supervisors express appreciation and best wishes to Mike and his family, and good luck in your personal endeavors. Passed and adopted by the Board of Supervisors of the County of Del Norte, State of California, this 14th day of February, 2017.
Mr. Marks, if you feel like you want to say a few words.
Thank you, board members. It's been a privilege and an honor to serve Del Norte County Probation Department, and the 26 years, I would do it again. I'm very proud to work for this agency, and it's time to hit the road. So
enjoy.
Thank you very much.
Enjoy.
Congratulations.
Okay, at this time, we'll move on with other items, the budget transfer items. I'll entertain a motion, and if you want to do them together, items number 21 and 22. 21 is approve and adopt budget transfer 02-02 in the amount of $12,000 within the jail budget for the urgent need of a communications repeater as requested by the sheriff coroner. And number 22, approve and adopt budget transfer 02-03 in the amount of $3,500 with the professional services budget to cover the cost of housing AB-109 eligible clients as requested by the chief probation officer. Is there a motion?
Wait a minute. And 02-04. Right. 23 is also included. Next page.
I'm sorry. My omission. Thank you. The third one is approve and adopt budget transfer 02-04 in the amount of $21,912 within the Bar O Boys Ranch budget to cover the work required at Bar O Ranch as a result of fire for the demolition and removal of the burned manufacturing home as requested by the county administrative officer. So there's items 02, 03, and 04.
Move to approve budget transfers 02-02, 02-03, and 02-04.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any comment from the audience, public comment at this time? Seeing none, we'll close that. We'll bring it back to the board for any discussion, any further discussion. And Kylie, if you would please call the roll.
Supervisor Cowan?
Yes.
Supervisor Hemmingson?
Yes.
Supervisor Berkowitz?
Yes.
Vice Chair Gitlin?
Yes. Okay, item number 24, approve and authorize the chair to sign the attached letter commenting on CAL FIRE's draft forest carbon plan as requested by the Natural Resources Goal Committee. Now, if I'm not mistaken, that is you, Supervisor Hemmingson, and do you wish to discuss that or let Randy Hooper?
I'll let Randy, he put a letter together for us, and it was well done.
Okay. Where did you all have a chance to look at the letter? Are there any questions about it? Would you like a rundown of the climate
plan, or are there any questions?
What do we have bullets? Can you give us the bullets on it?
Sure. So the forest carbon plan is a plan that's being developed by the Governor's Forest Climate Action Team. This is under the leadership of CAL FIRE, Cal EPA, and the Natural Resources Agency. The plan's obviously been developed to draft status, and it's now out for public review and comment. I think at its core, the Forest Carbon Plan is essentially a plan that outlines a multi-tiered strategy for essentially utilizing the state's forest land resources to advance the state's goals to reduce greenhouse gas emissions under AB 32. In terms of the strategy itself, the plan calls for more active management of the forests. This would be in order to thin out what has, I think, fair to say, become an artificially dense forest throughout the state. This has led to things like forest fires and dead and decaying trees, which are all contributing to the greenhouse gas emissions problem. You know, essentially with the forest fires and the dead and decaying trees, the forest has essentially become a net emitter of greenhouse gas emissions rather than a carbon sink, like it potentially could be if it was managed appropriately. From that perspective, in terms of the active management, I think there's a lot of things to like with the draft plan. This could potentially open up things like timber harvest within the state's managed timberlands. It also puts more emphasis and pressure on the federal land management agencies to do similar things within the federally managed lands. And so from that perspective, I think this could be something that the board would likely be supportive of. The Natural Resources Committee, as it was indicated, did review the concept of the plan kind of in a rough fashion. There was direction from staff to put a letter together where there was some analysis of the carbon plan itself. In looking at it, you know, again, I highlighted some of the positive things that I think from a community perspective we can agree on. Some of the other things which I think potentially could be cause for concern within the carbon plan would be an emphasis on preventing the conversion of forest lands vis-a-vis further public ownership or public acquisition of lands, state and federal agencies acquiring additional currently private lands within places like ours. In addition, pushing the idea of further conservation easements, which would, again, kind of speak to the issue of conversion of forest lands or preventing conversion of forest lands. And so what I tried to do in the letter was to get behind the concept of more active, proactive management of the forest itself and the forest resources, the timber resources, but also highlight the difficulty that this board would likely have with acquisition by state and federal agencies of private lands in the county. According to the Chico State's economic demographic profile of the county, I think the most recent estimate is we're approaching 80% of the lands in Del Norte County is being publicly owned or managed. And so, you know, while that might be an issue in terms of forest management and other areas, in terms of those conversions that I spoke of, in Del Norte County, we're not going to have that issue. With 80% of our lands being publicly owned or managed, we don't need any more. It's, I highlighted in the letter, it's eroding the county's ability to deliver services that we're committed to vis-a-vis the general fund when we're not recovering the tax dollars from the private lands like we would have in the past. That's a problem. And so there's some language in the letter that speaks to the no net loss policy. I did include a copy of the no net loss policy in the letter, and hopefully that conveys the position of this board fairly and accurately. If there's any questions.
Board members, questions for Mr. Hooper?
No, I think you did an excellent job, Randy, as always. You're very thorough. Did a great job. I appreciate it. And with that, I'll make the motion that we authorize the chair to sign the attached letter.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. And I will now ask for public input on this. Anybody from the public wishes to address this, ask a question of Mr. Hooper or the forest carbon plan in general? Seeing none, we have a motion and a second. We'll call the vote.
Supervisor Cowan?
Yes.
Supervisor Hemmingson?
Yes.
Supervisor Berkowitz?
Yes.
Vice Chair Gitlin?
Yes. Okay, item number 25. This is Good idea. I was looking for you there. Introduce the attached Title 19 environmental ordinance to recodify by title and waive first reading. Number two, set the ordinance for adoption at the February 28th regular meeting of the Board of Supervisors. And number three, direct the clerk of the board to publish the pre-adoption summary of the ordinance and to post a certified copy of the full text of the proposed ordinance in the office of the Board of Supervisors. Both publication and posting must be done at least 5 days prior to the board meeting, at which ordinance will be adopted as requested by the Director of Community Development Department. Heidi, please fill us in what's going on here.
Good morning. In July 2016, your board adopted ordinance 2016-003, which created Title 19 Fire Safe Regulations. It was later discovered that Title 19 was already given to the environmental regulations for the county. California government code allows for the recodification and recompilation of county codes as needed by the Board of Supervisors, by the county. In this case, having two titles with the same name is obviously very confusing, and it creates an issue for information technology to place the ordinance onto the county code. So obviously, we need to get this corrected as quickly as possible. So we had two options. One, change Title 21 Fire Safe Regulations to another title, or change the environmental chapter to another. And we chose to change the environmental chapter to Title 22. And this is essentially replacing it 100% in kind, word for word. The only changes are where it may have been Section 19.04, it will now be 22.04. The reason we did this, though, is that the fire safe regulations have to be certified by the California Board of Forestry. And if we had to take, if we made the change, we would have to go back to the Board of Forestry. And in this case, by changing environment, the action of the board will suffice. So if you have any questions, I'm available to board respond. Members,
I did have one question with regard to the 5 day prior. I thought it was 72 hours. Is this something, because it's an ordinance, it's an additional date?
That was taken directly from code.
Okay, so normally when we post an agenda, it's 72 hours. What am I doing this right? That's 4 days?
I think I would have to defer to.
Yeah, 24, 48 is two.
Clerk of the board.
The 5 days suffice. The 72 hours is for the government code, okay. Referring to the board, not to ordinances.
It was more of a question of curiosity. Public comments on this, please approach. If you have a public comment, yes or no? No? Okay, any other comments from the public on this? Otherwise, then we'll close public comments and we'll call for any additional board comment or question. Having seen none, go ahead, Kylie, let's call the roll on this.
I need a motion.
I make a motion to approve.
I'm sorry, I thought we had done that. And do we have a second to it?
I'll second it.
Okay. All right, so we have a motion and a second on item number 25, and let's call the vote.
Supervisor Hemmingson?
Yes.
Supervisor Berkowitz?
Yes.
Supervisor Cowan?
Yes.
Vice Chair Gitlin?
Yes. And let's move on to 26. Approve and authorize the chair to sign the draft comment letter to the Redwood National and State Parks regarding the reintroduction of the California condor as requested by the Natural Resources Goal Committee. Again, I'll defer to you first, Supervisor Hemmingson, and for further explanation, or to defer it to Heidi and CDD.
This is a discussion that we had. The the Redwood National and State Parks is going to reintroduce the condor. They had some options. I don't remember exactly what number alternative we picked,
six.
Yeah. But anyway, it was, I think, the least objectionable, basically. Heidi, you want to speak to that a little bit?
Yes, there were three options. One was no action, which would be not to reintroduce it. The second was an action alternative, but it would be to designate the endangered species, the California condor, as an experimental population. Right. And then the third would be to reintroduce the California condor, but not introduce it as an experimental population, which would mean that it would be fully protected under the Endangered Species Act.
Very good. Do I have a motion to approve and authorize the chair?
I'll move to approve and authorize.
Second.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Public comments at this time? Seeing none, let's call a vote on this.
Supervisor Cowan?
Yes.
Supervisor Berkowitz?
Yes.
Supervisor Hemmingson?
Yes.
Vice Chair Gitlin?
Yes. Okay, this is item number 27. Approve and authorize the chair to send a letter of support to Warden Dukart for the return of level one inmate work crews in Del Norte County as requested by myself. And I think what I would like to do is explain that, that this is at no cost to Del Norte County. And hold on 1 second, sir. If you have something to say, we'll have give you an opportunity in a second. So I think we've seen that, the letter, board members, you've all seen this. I will entertain a motion to approve that letter at this time. Is there so motion to request?
I'll make the motion.
And is there a second?
Second.
Second, okay. We have a motion and a second. And then I'll open it up to public comments. Sir, did you wish to say something? You were gesturing me, so. Well, then you can't, then hold on, hold on, hold on. If it's not about this subject, we have to, then. No, we can't do it. I'm sorry. Not during this time period for this item. No. Okay. I apologize. Okay.
Not doing anything about the mold in the Veterans Memorial Building, and now we're taught again that you're condemning it.
Okay.
Not doing nothing so it can be condemned, and then the county will take it over for officers. The veterans are not going to let you do it!
There is a time and place to express your opinion, which was the 10:25 public hour. That's when we do it. You can't just bring something in because you want to talk about it when it's not in the. We're all about rules here. We have to follow the rules, whether I agree with them or not. So my apologies to the constituent. Hopefully in the next few days, we'll look into that. Jay, can you please validate if there's any valid comments that he's making on this?
No, there aren't. The mold issue, there is some issues over there for a couple of the offices upstairs. We're working with the sea cadets right now in regards to one space up there, but what Mr. Cox is referring to is not correct. There are certain rules and regulations around memorial halls, and I will try to reach out to Sarge and see if we can clarify some of that.
Thank you. All right, so we're back to item 27. We have a motion and we have a second. Are there any other public comments on this item only, number 27? Having seen none, we'll close public comment and we'll bring it to a vote.
Supervisor Cowan?
Yes.
Supervisor Hemmingson?
Yes.
Supervisor Berkowitz?
Yes.
Vice Chair Gitlin?
Yes. Okay, so now we'll move on to item number 28, consider miscellaneous budget matters pertinent to the County of Del Norte, authorize the chair to sign any appropriate letters with respect to matters pending before the state or federal governments. Jay, I'm going to refer to you. Is there anything there that needs to be on our radar screen?
Beyond what's on the agenda right now, I would say no. Regarding the budget section, the board will see a mid-year budget review and report at the next meeting. We had a few departments that were slow in getting the information and projections into the auditor, which then prevents us from getting all the reports together to show what the overall picture is. But we will continue to bring forward the legislative items as they come up. They appear to be popping up very rapidly right now.
Very good. Let's move on to item number 29, approve and authorize the chair to sign and send a letter of support for Senate Bill. This is the transportation funding and reform package. I'm sorry. Is there anything to approve? Is there any action on 28?
Is this just information, Jay?
This was an approve and adopt. This is a return of an item in regards to Senate Bill 1 that was requested by the board.
We're mixing up issues. Supervisor Cowan, were you referring to 28?
I am.
Okay. Is there anything in 28, Jay, that needs to be addressed?
No, there is nothing on that.
Let's move on to 29. Okay, 29 will be an action item. Approve and authorize the chair to sign and send a letter of support for Senate Bill 1. That's the transportation funding and reform package. to Senator Beal and Assemblymember Frazier as requested by the County Administrative Officer. And Jay, before you do take this, this has been before our board before. There was some concern about the allocation of what this bill would look like. I saw your redrafted letter. It's much more appealing. It's more general. So please tell us what we didn't know the last time we met.
Well, I don't know that you didn't know anything on the last one, but the reiteration in the letter was to generalize it, to not give specific support to SB and AB1, because some of the issues in there that were brought up by the board the last time. I believe the board very strongly indicated that a need for a transportation bill. However, as we know, this the bill that was not necessarily, it was discussed but not approved in 2017 is being rolled over, or 2016 is rolled over to 2017. That was not palatable to the board, and you had asked for a rewrite of the letter to be more general, but to also support a transportation funding package from the state, which is what the, I believe the letter now says.
Supervisors, any comments or questions to CAO Serena on this? I do have one. I'll let my colleagues speak first. So Jay, my question having to do with this particular letter, which I think is appropriate, is there any new information since the last time we met on this bill that we didn't know January 24th, which I think was our last meeting?
Not at this time.
Okay, that's all I wanted to
know. It's going to take them quite a bit of time to debate this out and come up with a package. They haven't been successful in the last 2 years.
All right, I'll entertain a motion on item 29, which is approve and authorize the chair to sign and send a letter of support for Senate Bill 1. And I'll
so ask, move. Second.
And we have a motion by Supervisor Hemmingson, seconded by Supervisor Berkowitz. Any additional public comment on this letter? Seeing none, we'll close public comment and we'll call a vote. Carrie?
Supervisor Cowan?
Yes.
Supervisor Berkowitz?
Yes.
Supervisor Hemmingson?
Yes.
Vice Chair Gitlin?
Yes. Okay, and we're at item number 30. You know what, let's take 31 first. I'm going to do 31 first. Approve and authorize the chair to send a letter of support for SB 58, Wildlife Management Areas, Payment of Taxes and Assessments, as requested by the County Administrative Officer. Let's take 31 first. Jay, if you would.
Senator Mike McGuire has reintroduced legislation that would once again ask the governor, and then hopefully he would pass this bill, to make the payment in lieu of taxes mandatory instead of permissive. 2 years ago, the governor changed the language, which then put the state in a position of either deciding to pay or not pay for lands that are taken off the tax rolls when there's a purchase by essentially the Department of Fish and Wildlife through the Wildlife Conservation Board, and those lands are turned into wildlife areas. In the letter that you see here, it supports Senator McGuire's legislation, which the board has previously supported. Last year that was not taken up and was essentially then defeated. In this letter there's also a very there's a comment in regards to the money that is owed to counties in arrears. Senator McGuire and I have talked, although he is very skeptical that that's a possibility under the legislation that he's proposing, he understands Del Norte County's interest in seeing that the state of California pay their fair share in their bills. For a little bit of history, in 2003 the state discontinued payments to counties. They reintroduced paying in 2015, but under the new language, and the amount that's being paid to the counties is apportioned out, and we receive about $20,000 a year. The money in arrears was between 2003 and 2015, and it's a significant amount of money, but that is appears to be being ignored by the state. So we continue to advocate for them to not only pay the annual payment, but also that that's owed to the county in arrears. Governor disagrees.
Okay. I would move for approval of to send a letter of support for SB 58.
Second.
I have a motion by Supervisor Hemmingson and a second by Supervisor Cowan. to send a letter of support for SB 58 Wildlife Management.
That's Supervisor Berkowitz.
I'm sorry.
Seconded by Berkowitz.
Correction on that. My hearing is going both sides. Supervisor Berkowitz for the second. Any public comment on this? Okay.
Victoria Dickey. Not fully versed on whether or not the state really has the right to just automatically, unilaterally change an agreement with the counties after they've taken the benefit of the bargain. But anybody else could send them a little letter and say, you're in violation, we're taking our land back. I don't know why you don't think of doing that. Maybe I'm just off base, but your attorney would certainly know whether or not that can be done. The other alternative is send them a 3-day notice. I'll draft that one.
Unlawful detainer. Okay. That's almost funny. Yes. No additional public comments at this time, so we'll close public comments on 31. Any additional board comments, questions? I'll call the vote. Right.
Supervisor Cowan?
Yes.
Supervisor Berkowitz?
Yes.
Supervisor Hemmingson? Vice Chair Gitlin?
Yes. All right, so let's go to 30 at this point. And 30 is discuss and give direction to staff regarding Senate Bill 54. It's called the California Values Act, as requested by the County Administrative Officer. Jay?
So this is essentially the state sanctuary bill. And as the Vice Chairman has just mentioned, it is not necessarily titled that under the code. It's an amendment to some existing legislation that would, as previously discussed with the resolution, place the all of the entities within the state of California in a position as to not necessarily assist the Federal Department of Immigration in regards to holds within counties. And it, as mentioned before, it is opposed by the State Association of Sheriffs. And it was placed on the agenda because it does have statewide significance. It does have county significance, although we don't know exactly what that will be. When a state does not cooperate with the federal government, there is potential for ramifications, both financial and otherwise. But obviously, in this case, this is most likely going to be supported all the way through our governor and will be passed. The concern that I have personally in looking at the legislation is that it does make certain or put certain handcuffs, no pun intended, on the sheriff, because they're the ones that enforce the law. From a financial standpoint, by passing it, we do not know how the federal government is going to react, essentially the administration, in regards to financing pass-throughs that come through the state in two counties, and that is relatively significant. So at this point, it was placed on as a discussion and direction item because it is not part of our legislative platform, and the board would then discuss that and give direction. Then in addition was the urgency item that was discussed by the board earlier regarding a resolution. But at this point, it was for the board to discuss and give direction.
Colleagues, any comments, direction?
Yes.
Supervisor Berkowitz.
I can't for the life of me figure out why we want to, as a state, play chicken with the federal government. It is beyond me, all right, when we get so much money from the federal government that the state says they're not going to cooperate with the federal government. Think of the problems. Let's take a look at just a couple of them. Let's assume that the state goes through with this, and the federal government says, well, there are certain programs we're not going to fund. How about those considered with the Older Americans Act? Think of the money that we would lose with those people who rely on Meals on Wheels that we provide as pass-through from the federal government. There are people, there are older people, basically, who rely on Meals on Wheels for their one meal a day. For the federal government to deny this is unconscionable. But they wouldn't deny it unless the state took action to make it into a sanctuary state. This has horrible repercussions for us. Just because, for no other reason, than the state wants to examine and promote its dominance in one particular area. I don't mind if San Francisco and LA and any of those other areas want to declare a sanctuary city. That's their problem. But when it affects the very lives of people here in Del Norte County, that makes it our problem. And that's why I would like to introduce a motion that says, let us just say no to this California, this so-called California Values Act, basically the sanctuary cities.
So let me understand, Supervisor Berkowitz, you want to introduce a motion at this time to oppose Senate Bill 54.
That's correct.
All right, do we have a second? I will second it. Okay, so now we have a motion and a second to oppose Senate Bill 54.
I have a question.
And now is your opportunity to say, ask those.
We don't have to pass anything, right, Jay? This is just information right now, correct? Because I'm very curious about the whole security, like we talked about. What are the trickle down effects?
Well,
so
I'm sorry, go ahead.
So today is my understanding we're just discussing this. And whether we do one thing or the other, what difference does that make right now?
The board is never required to take action.
Thank you.
But this is legislation that does have a potential effect statewide and on the county in regards to what might happen. We could speculate on what can happen. Obviously, what Supervisor Berkowitz had just brought up regarding funding and financing, that's definitely a possibility. We don't know.
Okay.
The action by the state, the governor in this case, sets that administration's policy, basically. Individual cities have enacted legislation or ordinances to become sanctuary cities. Del Norte County has not done that, neither does the city of Crescent City that I'm aware of. But as far as action on this, if there's additional information that the board wants, I will try to dig up additional information. But I think a lot of it will be speculative over time. Does that help?
Well, if I'm understanding, this is supposed to be some sort of direction to staff to come back with something for us, whether that has to do with what the implications are, or if that has to do with you writing a letter in opposition and bringing it back for approval. It's got to, in my opinion, it's one of those things.
The board could certainly act today to tell me write a letter of opposition. They could take no action, ask for additional information. Or you can take up the other item if that's appropriate at this point.
Where I'm getting the difference between saltwater and freshwater on this issue is you're asking for direction. That's clearly.
Discussion
it's not
and
just
direction.
Discuss, it's give you direction on the board's feelings on this particular issue. Give directions they have regarding Senate Bill 54. And that's what we're doing right here on this august body.
Yes.
We're giving you direction. I sense there is some difference of opinion on this. As I'm just reading the tea leaves of my colleagues here. Supervisor Cowan is correct. We don't have to do anything. We just let it go. Or we can take a position at this time, and that position can be communicated to you, CEO Serena. Is that my understanding?
Yes, I think to clarify and maybe to speak more to Supervisor Cowan's question, if the board does not act to oppose or to stand in favor and support it, the actions of the sheriff are going to be consistent with what the federal law is anyway, as of right now. And I'm not sure legally how that's going to affect his requirements for upholding the law if the state passes this legislation. We are an arm of the state, so that I think that's going to definitely muddy the waters. But he has certain obligations as the law enforcement agent of Del Norte County. The policy of the Board of Supervisors is what we're discussing today. But again, once that, if that legislation passes, which it appears that it's going in that direction, I think there's going to be a number of questions on how that affects those individual agencies on enforcing the law and cooperating with the federal government.
And again, I can't answer for the Sheriff's Department and what they will or will not do. They've taken an oath to uphold the federal constitution and the state constitution. So I would only say that it's a moot point whether we support that, continue to take your oath, in this case the federal constitution. I see this as just an underscoring of support for the sheriff to continue to do his job of law enforcement. Whether he chooses to or not is not something I can answer to. He's taken an oath to uphold law. So I don't know if that's a relevant question, but in any event, I guess we can debate this back and forth. Any other public comment wishing to make a comment on this this time? Okay, then we'll ask for that vote. You have a motion and you have a second, so.
I think
to let our staff know that we oppose, yes or no, Senate Bill 54. Is that my understanding correctly?
Let me revise the motion if somebody will revise the second. Basically, I think what we should be doing here is giving direction to staff to write a letter in opposition of Senate Bill 54.
Okay, are you withdrawing
your
motion?
I'm withdrawing the motion.
Okay, and I'll withdraw my second.
Okay.
All right, now that's the directing staff.
Correct.
Now, can we do this, or does this is a, we need board consensus on this?
You'll need board consensus on direction to staff, yes.
Okay, so where do we stand on this? This is not a vote, then this is a consensus.
Yeah, you can just direct staff by consensus.
Okay, Supervisor Cowan, yes or no? Do you support sending?
Yes, I support a letter.
You do support a letter opposing 54?
Correct.
Okay, Supervisor Hamilton?
I would support a letter coming back to the board for approval.
Yes, okay, that would be once it's drafted, it comes back to us.
Correct.
Supervisor?
Yes.
And I too. So the board, you'll draft a letter indicating that CEO Serena, and it'll come back on the 28th meeting. All right, have we covered filled in all the blanks on here? Did I miss any subjects? I don't think so. Kylie, you'll let us know about that February 21st date, and we are adjourned.